All right. That's the case, then we'll proceed further. Okay, so we started our discussion. Of lipids, right? So in that I told you that these are hydrophobic and you basically have fatty acids. Okay, lipids, the lowest component we can say is fatty acids. And these fatty acids are nothing but long chain carboxylic acids, right? Long chain carboxylic acids. Now, these long chain carboxylic acids, they can have hydrogen bonds they can have double bonds or they can be without double bonds. If they don't have any double bonds in their structure, we call them saturated fatty acids. No double bonds. Okay, now if they have one or more double bonds, then we call them unsaturated fatty acids. Right, I already showed you some examples. Now, within this unsaturated fatty acids, you can have cis form or the trans form. And I told you most of the natural fatty acids exist in the cis form. Most of the natural fatty acids exist in the cis form. Okay, and they can be more than one disulfide. Double bond. There can be more than one double bond. Okay. Now, we were looking at a few examples yesterday. And the other thing that you have to remember is whenever there is a double bond, okay, whenever there is a double bond, there is a bend introduced in the structure. There's a bend introduced in the structure. Okay. A bend is actually introduced in the structure itself. Now, and we were looking at a few examples of fatty acids. These are a few examples of fatty acids. So you can see the examples here have almost 20 carbon. Okay, and the number of double bonds is 4 double bonds. At what position are they present? Delta 5, that is one double bond is present. First of all cis. This is something that you have to note. All cis. Right, all cis, all in cis fashion. All in cis fashion, that means between fifth and sixth position, there is a double bond and the hydrogen, which is attached to the fifth and the sixth carbon is on the same side. Then we call it cis. If the hydrogens were arranged in this fashion, okay, this is trans. I know you all know your basic mathematics. A transverse is something which actually is diagonal. Okay, so this is a transposition, right? Transposition. So these are the things which we discussed yesterday, and that is where we actually stopped. Yeah, the other thing that I want to emphasize is the carbon numbering can be done in two ways. One is they can be numbered 1, 2, 3, 4, so on and so forth, or they can be numbered alpha, beta, gamma, delta, so on and so forth. Okay, but when you are labeling them as alpha, beta, gamma, or delta, the alpha carbon would be the second carbon, not the first one. The numbering will start with the second one. The numbering will start with the second one, not the first one. Okay. And no matter how many carbons you have, no matter you have 6 carbons or 7 carbons or 9 carbons, the last carbon is always represented as omega. Okay. And the last carbon, the omega carbon, always has a methyl group. It's not CH2. It will be basically H, H, and H. Okay. So just to give you a sense. Yeah, you can see here. So this is your omega carbon. Okay. This is your omega carbon with CH3. The last carbon will be always CH3. Okay. Now, yeah, this is one way to represent this. I've shown this already. Okay. 18 carbons, one double bond. At what position is the double bond? In some textbooks, you will find the structure represented in this fashion. Okay. Then, and this is important. Okay. We have seen how an amino acid, if you remember amino acid structure, okay, you have COOH, NH3 plus H and R. This is the basic structure or the skeleton of the amino acid. This is common for all the amino acids. The R group keeps changing. We know that already. Now, what happens when you increase the pH of the medium? Okay, or in other words, at the physiological pH. So what's the pH in our body? Okay, the physiological pH. When you say physiological pH, we are talking about the pH of the human body contents. Okay, so predominantly, if you're not talking about the gastric HCl, which is actually released in your stomach, we're not talking about the pH there. The general pH So the general pH is around 7.2 or somewhat towards the basic side. Okay, somewhat towards the basic side. So at the physiological pH, what will happen to the amino acid? The carboxylic acid will definitely lose its, because at around, if you look at the list of the PK1s and PK2s, most of them will have a PK1 below 4 pH. Okay, so around 4 pH, they start losing the, around pH 4, they start losing the carboxylic acid proton. Okay, and the amino group will lose the proton much later. But at physiological pH, most of the amino acids are in their zwitterionic structure. Or to be specific, COO minus will be there. Okay, whether it is NH3 plus or whether it is NH2, this will definitely be COO minus. Okay, in the same way, all the fatty acids have a carboxylic acid group. At the physiological pH, okay, that is the pH in our body, at the pH in our body, we have the fatty acids in the COO minus form, just like your amino acid carboxylic acid group. The carboxylic acid group, even in the fatty acids, will lose the proton, will lose the H, okay, and it becomes COO minus. So when you ate, the structure was like this. When you ate something, the structure was like this, let's say, but the minute it's in your body, it is now becoming COO minus. That is, you are eating palmitic acid, and the minute it is in your body, it is becoming palmitate. Okay, so essentially both are the same. The only thing is, depending on the pH, the molecule will exist either as COOH or COO minus. If it is present as COOH, we call it palmitic acid. If it is present as COO minus, we call it palmitate. Palmitate is the palmitic acid with the H lost, so that now it is COO minus. In the same way, oleic acid, when it is COOH, and oleate, when it is COO minus. Okay, so you might see in different textbooks, they refer to the palmitic acid as palmitic acid or palmitate. You just have to understand the core concept here. Okay, if it's in physiological pH, if it is at physiological pH, we call it palmitate because it is ionized. Okay, it is ionized, COO minus. It's now COO minus. If it is in its natural state, okay, at more towards the lower pH, it exists as palmitic acid where it has COOH group. Okay. Now I'll introduce a molecule. And this molecule, which you see, can somebody tell me what molecule is this? Anyone? Looking at the structure, can you just tell me which molecule it is? Yep, I have one answer. Let's see. Okay. Nicola says it's glyceraldehyde. Tanya says it's glycerol. Okay. So, Nicola, if this was O, CHO, then you are correct. It's glyceraldehyde. Okay. And Tanya, you are exactly correct. This is, I don't know whether I'm pronouncing your name correctly or not, but this is glycerol. Okay, this is glycerol. I'll get to a minute why we are talking about glycerol now. Now, glycerol has a basic structure like this, even though it is written as CH2OH, the actual form is CH, H, and OH. So CH2OH. Getting that right? CH2OH. For simplicity, it is written in this fashion, that's all. Okay, so all of them has a hydroxyl group. All of them has a hydroxyl group. Now, this molecule is important. This molecule is very important because in any system, not just in human body, in any system, fat is or fatty acids are stored in the form of something called triacylglycerol. Fatty acids are stored in the form of triacylglycerol. Okay, fatty acids are stored in the form of, so the fat that is stored under your skin or in your hip region is nothing but your triacylglycerol. Okay, so the fat that is under the skin or your hip region, okay, wherever the fat deposits are there in your body, the fat is triacylglycerol, or it is also called as neutral fat. It's also called as neutral fat. Okay, this neutral fats actually get deposited under your skin. The triacylglycerols get deposited under skin. Now, what is acyl here? Okay. Acyl is, if you have an oxoacid, like your carboxylic acid, and if it loses its hydroxyl group, sorry about that. If it loses its hydroxyl group, okay, or let me just put it this way, oxoacid minus OH group, okay, oxoacid minus OH group is what you will get is an acyl group. Okay, so we talked about the fatty acid. Fatty acid is a long chain. Okay, a long chain with C double bond O, OH. And then you have CH2, so on and so forth. And ultimately you have a CH3. If it loses this and becomes C double bond O and gets attached to something else with its chain already present, this chain already present, okay, then we call this an acyl molecule. We call it an acyl molecule. Okay, that's the first part. Now we are saying triacyl. So it basically has three acyl molecules. The neutral fat in our body has three acyl molecules. Okay, what are those acyl molecules? So we already saw the structure of fatty acid. Let me just pull it out again. Yeah. Okay. Let's get a simpler one. Okay. So you have a fatty acid now. Okay. And then you have your glycerol. Okay. You have fatty acid and glycerol. So between this fatty acid and glycerol, a water molecule is lost. Between this and this, okay, let me just correct that. This is lost and this will be lost as water molecule. And we end up with, okay, we end up with this thing. Let me just show you. Direct diagram, that would be better. Okay, so you have, so the minute it loses its OH, this becomes acyl. Okay, so here a water molecule is lost. Basically the carboxylic acid group of the fatty acid is losing its OH and it is becoming acyl. And you have a H coming from here and the bond that is formed here. What's the bond that is formed as a result of acid plus alcohol? What do you call the bond that results from a reaction between acid and alcohol? Anyone? Whenever an acid and an alcohol reacts, a bond is formed. What do you call that bond? Sorry?
Ester bond.
Ester bond, perfect. Perfect. We see the formation of a ester bond. Okay, so this is what happens. So a water molecule is lost and this bond is formed, which we call the ester linkage. Okay, an ester linkage is actually formed. Okay, so like I said, glycerol has not just one, but three OH groups. So it has the ability to react with three different fatty acids. Okay, the three fatty acids will now lose their hydroxyl group. So three fatty acids losing their hydroxyl group is triacyl or triacyl, right? Triacyl. And what do you have? Glycerol. So it's called acyl glycerol. Okay, so it's a fat molecule in crude terms or in the common terms, we call it fat molecule. Okay, the fat molecule that you see is nothing but triacyl glycerol. So it has a glycerol backbone and then it has three fatty acid chains. Now the question is, will the three fatty acids be the same? Will they all be, let's say, palmitic acid or palmitate? Will they all be palmitate? Not necessary. Okay. You might have the three same fatty acids attached to the glycerol, or you might have a combination of different things. You have palmitic acid here, stearic acid here, and a oleic acid here. You can have different combinations Okay. Or you can have the same fatty acids being attached to the glycerol molecule. Whether it is the same fatty acid or different fatty acids, we still call it a triacyl glycerol because they are three acyl molecules which are actually attached to the glycerol moiety. Okay. You understood the basic structure of triacyl glycerol here? Any doubts?
No, sir.
Great. Okay. Now, so if you want to take a closer look at the reaction, this is how the reaction is. So you have glycerol, okay? And between those three glycerols, three water molecules are lost. Okay, three water molecules are lost and these are directly attached to the glycerol moiety with an ester linkage. This is something that you have to remember. This is basic, okay? Acid plus alcohol when they react, an ester bond is formed. Okay? Okay. Now, this neutral fat is mainly stored in the mammal, in the mammals, it is mainly stored in the adipose cells. Okay, adipose cells or adipose tissue. Okay, you see a lot of adipose tissue mainly under your skin. Okay, and under your skin and some of the deposits can be found in the kidney as well. Okay, you see a lot of adipose tissue in these regions. Okay, now the reason why adipose tissue under skin is important, the adipose tissue under skin is important, is because this adipose tissue that is present under skin provides insulation. Okay, the polar bears which are in the Arctic, okay, or Antarctic, I'm sorry. So they have very thick adipose tissue. Okay, they have very thick adipose tissue. The fat gets deposited there and a thick layer of adipose tissue is present in them because of which they are able to resist the sub-zero temperatures. Okay, the minus 20s, 30s, minus 50 degrees centigrade temperature, they're able to resist the temperature and they are able to survive because of the adipose tissue that is deposited under their skin. Okay, not just that, your body, the neutral fat or the triacyl glycerols is the one which is actually the storage form of lipid in your body. So the energy is stored in your body. So I told you that if you eat excess glucose, some of it is actually stored in the form of glycogen and the rest is stored in the form of fat, right? I'm talking about the neutral fat or the triacyl glycerols. Okay, and I already told you that glycogen is highly hydrophilic. That's the reason why our body won't store the entire carbohydrate in the form of excess glucose in the form of glycogen, because glycogen, if you take 1 gram of glycogen, it will absorb 2 grams of water. Okay, just imagine how much water will start absorbing if the entire body starts storing glucose in the form of glycogen. Okay, I might have exaggerated a bit when I said, you might weigh 700 kilograms. It's not that drastic, but still you can see the consequences here. 1 gram is actually absorbing 2 grams of water. Okay, but if you take fat, the same 1 gram of fat stores almost 6 times the energy that is stored in glycogen. Okay, it can store 6 times the energy occupying only a tiny portion of your body. And that's the reason why excess glucose or excess whatever energy resource, energy providing resources you have, all that is actually stored in the form of fat in the body. Okay. Now, just to give you a sense of how important the storage is, okay, how important the storage is, how important it is to store the neutral fat, I'll just give you this example. Now, this is an American bird. It's called a plover. Okay, so this migrates from Alaska, which is almost towards the it's almost a separate state towards the left of Canada, actually. So you can see this migrates from Alaska all the way to the southern tip of South America. Okay, southern tip of South America. So there's it basically flies through the entire ocean. Okay, it flies over the entire ocean. And since it is flying over the ocean, there's no chance of, you know, stopping for food or anything. So this gets entire energy. This bird gets entire energy from the stored fat. Okay, so it starts its flight. So it's almost close to 4,000 kilometers. So it gets the entire energy that is required for its flight from the stored fat. The fat is broken down very quickly, and that is what provides it energy to fly all the way from Alaska to the southern tip of South America. Okay, so the energy, the amount of energy that is stored in fat is immense, and it is very important. Okay. Now we'll move to the next concept, which is now classification of lipids is mainly based on what functions they perform. Okay, broadly, lipids perform two functions. One is the storage lipids. Okay, this is the storage lipid that we just talked about, the triacylglycerol. Okay, mainly for energy purposes. Then you have structural lipids. Structural lipids. Okay, now when I say structural lipids, these are the lipids that are present in your cell membrane, mainly in the cell membrane. Okay, now when I say cell membrane, the minute I say cell membrane, you think of only one membrane, that is your plasma membrane, right? I should say cell membranes, actually. Okay, the minute I say this, you think of a plasma membrane. So if you remember, let me see if I have the structure. Just give me a second. I'm just looking for the structure here. Okay, just give me a second. I'll just grab an image that makes it easier. Okay. All right, I'm sorry for the delay. Here we go. Okay, so if you look at the structure, you will see that the membrane, okay, is made up of, you can see this head, and then you will see a couple of tails like this. You'll see a couple of tails like this. Okay, so the same thing, this is one layer, and then you have the bottom layer in the same fashion. Okay, so this is how the structure is. So I'm talking about this part. See this? So you have one layer like this. This is one layer. And this is another layer. You have two layers. Okay, so that's the reason why it is called the lipid bilayer. Right? That's the reason why it is called the lipid bilayer. So you have two layers. And then in the membrane, you see lots of proteins distributed all over. Okay, I think I've shown this at some point. We discussed this. I don't remember when we were discussing glycolipids and glycoproteins probably. Okay, anyway, so you have these lipids. So basically the entire membrane structure is actually made up of your lipids. The entire membrane structure is actually made up of your lipids. Okay, specifically phospholipids. Okay, specifically phospholipids. So this single layer is called the phospholipid layer. And since you have two layers, this becomes phospholipid bilayer. So the entire structure of the cell membrane is because of this lipid layer. Okay, it's because of this lipid layer. You can imagine, so if I have to give an analogy here, you all know these oranges, right? Orange have, on the top they have a, you have to peel the outer layer before you can actually start eating the orange which is inside. Okay, now, so the outer layer of every cell is made up of your membrane, okay? And that membrane is nothing but a phospholipid bilayer. Now, there is a reason why I'm saying cell membranes, because not just your plasma membrane, but there are other things like your mitochondrial membrane, right? Then chloroplast membrane in the plants. All these membranes are also made up of the same lipids, the same phospholipid bilayer. They all have the same phospholipid bilayer. Don't just assume that it's only the cell membrane that is made up of that has this structure. Don't assume that only the cell membrane has this structure. The mitochondrial membrane has a similar structure. The chloroplast membrane has a similar structure. Okay, the endoplasmic reticulum membrane has a similar structure. The nuclear membrane has a similar structure. They all have the basic structure where it is made up of phospholipid bilayer. Okay, so lipids contribute to the structure of many different components in your in a cell, whether it is a bacterial cell or a human cell, whatever it is, lipids contribute to a major portion of the structural components of the various things that are present in your cells. Okay, so with that introduction, so basically you have storage lipids and structural lipids. The lipids which actually give structure to not just your cell membrane, but to the various cell organelles that are present in your body. Okay, so with that background, let's look at the classification of lipids. Storage lipids, like I said, are nothing but your neutral fat or it's called triacylglycerols. So in the triacylglycerols, you have the glycerol backbone, right? And then three fatty acids attached to it. These three fatty acids can be the same type of fatty acids or different kinds of fatty acids, right? These three can be the same fatty acid or different kinds of fatty acids. Now you have membrane lipids. The other thing is your membrane lipids. Okay, membrane lipids are nothing but your structural lipids. These lipids contributing to the structure of the various membranes. Okay, so you have within the membrane lipids, you have three categories: phospholipids, glycolipids, and archibacterial ether lipids. Archibacterial ether lipids. There's a small, there's a minor difference between this and the normal lipids. We'll get to that. We'll get to the ether lipids in a minute. So basically, what we have seen in triacylglycerols is an ester linkage. Okay, between the fatty acid and the glycerol, you see the formation of a ester linkage. Here, in these organisms, you see an ether linkage, not the ester. You see an ether linkage. So I'll just show you when we get there. But we'll focus on the phospholipids now. Okay, how are they different from your storage lipids? How are they different from your triacylglycerols? How are they different from your triacylglycerols? So they are different in just one position. Okay, the first two positions are still occupied by fatty acids. You still have the glycerol backbone. You have the two fatty acids. The only thing that is changing here is, so the third carbon, you have an OH. This is actually forming a bond with, this is losing water here, okay, and forming a bond with the phosphate moiety, okay, Okay, now this molecule, the triacylglycerol molecule, the triacylglycerol molecule, this is completely hydrophobic. Okay, this is completely hydrophobic because it doesn't have any charged groups. Okay, so there's no charge anywhere. And if you have, if a molecule has to interact with water, it should have charge. Without charge, the molecules cannot actually interact with water. So this is, this is a nonpolar molecule. So it lacks charge, so it cannot interact with water. In other words, it is hydrophobic. This is hydrophobic. On the other hand, now you see the introduction of this group. You see the introduction of this group, phosphate. And if you look at the structure of the phosphate, it has several negative charges on its surface. Okay, so because of this phosphate molecule being attached here, you have a polar end. So this end might still be non-polar. But you have a polar end. So one end has a charge. Okay, so the other end where you have two fatty acids, that part is non-polar. In other words, this part is hydrophilic. This can interact with water, and the rest of the molecule, is hydrophobic. One end is hydrophilic and the other end is hydrophobic. And if you remember, in one of the classes, I've mentioned that if a molecule has both hydrophilic and hydrophobic properties, okay, if the hydrophilic and hydrophobic properties are present in the same molecule, what do we call it? What's the term used for that? Anyone?
Amphipathic.
Perfect. Thank you, Nikhila. Amphipathic. Right? So if it is, if a molecule has both hydrophilic and hydrophobic nature, we call them amphipathic molecules. So phospholipids, are amphipathic. Okay, phospholipids are amphipathic. Okay, now let's go back to the structure here. Let me just, okay. So So we have phospholipids, and so the phospholipids can basically have two types again. The phospholipids can be basically of two types. One is with a phosphate at the third position and the glycerol as the backbone. Okay, all the phospholipids with the glycerol backbone are called glycerophospholipids. The backbone here is glycerol. So all the phospholipids, when you say phospholipid, it should definitely have a phosphate moiety at one position. Okay, at one position it should have a phosphate moiety. So the phospholipids will definitely have a phosphate molecule. Okay, the only thing that changes is the backbone. You can have a glycerol backbone or a sphingosine backbone. Okay, I'll show you the structure of sphingosine in a minute. But just understand this, it has a glycerol backbone or a sphingosine backbone. If the fatty acids and the phosphate moiety is attached to a glycerol backbone, we call it glycerophospholipid. If it is attached to the sphingosine backbone, we call it sphingolipids. Okay, we don't call them sphingophospholipids, not necessary. Sphingolipids indicates that they are phospholipids with a sphingosine backbone. Okay, they are phospholipids with a sphingosine backbone. You understood my point here? Just ignore this part. Just ignore alcohol or choline. Just remember X here. It can be any molecule. Okay, it can be any molecule. If it is phosphate on one end with the glycerol backbone, it becomes glycerophospholipids. If it is phosphate on end with sphingosine backbone, it becomes a sphingolipid. If you are not comfortable or if it makes it easy for you to remember, you can still call them sphingophospholipids. Okay, if it is easier for you to remember them. Okay, but the minute you see sphingolipids, they are talking about sphingophospholipids or a phospholipid with a sphingosine backbone. Okay, so all the phospholipids will have a polar head, and a non-polar tail, or a hydrophilic head and a hydrophobic tail. Okay, now there is a reason why I'm calling this an X molecule, because this can be any of the many different kinds of molecules. Let's look at the various molecules that can be attached to the phosphate here. Okay, let's look at the various molecules that can be attached to the phosphate here. Now, the X can be hydrogen. Okay, the X in the glycerophospholipid can be hydrogen. If it is hydrogen, we call it phosphatidic acid. If it is hydrogen, we call it phosphatidic acid. That means you have P, and to this P, you have a simple hydrogen attached here. Let me just go back. So here, instead of alcohol, I just have a hydrogen. Okay, if I just have a hydrogen here, then this glycerophospholipid will now be called, what do we call it? Phosphatidic acid. Okay, if it is an ethanolamine, if the X is ethanolamine, this is a structure of ethanolamine, CH2, CH2. NH3 plus. Okay, so if it is an ethanolamine, then we call it phosphatidyl ethanolamine. If it is H, phosphatidic acid, and then this keeps repeating, phosphatidyl, phosphatidyl. Okay, phosphatidyl, if it is ethanolamine, phosphatidyl ethanolamine. If it is a choline group, it becomes phosphatidyl choline. If it is a serine group, it becomes phosphatidyl serine. Okay, if it is a glycerol group, it becomes phosphatidyl glycerol. Okay, so you can have the glycerol backbone with two fatty acids attached, and then you have a phosphate at the third position. To that phosphate, you can have another glycerol moiety attached. Okay, another glycerol moiety, the same backbone moiety, can be attached to the phosphate again. We call it phosphatidyl glycerol. Okay, phosphatidyl glycerol. Then you can have inositol 4,5-bisphosphate, biphosphate or bisphosphate. You can call it biphosphate or bisphosphate. It's the same thing. Okay, so that becomes phosphatidyl inositol 4,5-bisphosphate. If it is phosphatidyl glycerol, this is something that you have to remember. Okay, it's called the cardiolipin. It's called cardiolipin. Okay, so again, where do you find these? You find them in the membranes, different membranes. Okay, how are they distributed? All of them are actually present in equal proportion, or in the membrane you see more of ethanolamine, more of choline? It depends on the membrane. Okay, I'll just give you an example. Okay, before jumping to the examples, let me just show you once. So what you see in the membrane, which is bilayered, is the hydrophilic head, which basically has your phosphate group with one of the X groups attached. Okay, one of the X groups attached. Here in this case, it is CH2, CH2, NH3+. This is ethanolamine. Okay, let's look at ethanolamine structure. NH3+. Are we looking at the same structure here? CH2, CH2? No. So this is choline. This is choline, NCH3. Okay, let's look at choline. CH2, CH2, NCH3+. So this is a phosphatidyl choline. This molecule is a phosphatidyl choline. Okay, so the phosphate group and the glycerol moiety, this entire thing is acting as a polar head, hydrophilic head. This part can actually interact with water. The two fatty acid chains, okay, this is a saturated fatty acid. That's the reason why you are seeing a straight chain. But this is an unsaturated fatty acid, because of which you are seeing a bend. Okay. Now, so the two fatty acid chains here are hydrophobic. That's the reason why they don't want to interact with water. That's the reason they are sitting in the middle. Okay. This side, let's say this is the cell membrane. So this side you have your cytoplasm, which is majorly water, and this side you have extracellular fluid, the fluid that is interacting with the outside components, extracellular fluid. So you have a lot of water this side, you have a lot of water this side. So these tails, they are hydrophobic, they don't want to interact with water. That's the reason why they are sitting in the middle. The heads are still hydrophilic because of the phosphate group and the groups are actually attached, the charge groups attached to it, and some extent the glycerol component. This is actually giving the polar nature or the hydrophilic nature to the head. The heads are on the outside. They can happily interact with water. They don't have any problem interacting with water. And that's the reason why you're getting this typical structure for the cell membrane. The hydrophobic regions, which don't want to interact with water, are staying in the middle, and the hydrophilic heads, okay, the hydrophilic heads which can interact with the water are staying on either side. Okay, one half is actually interacting with cytoplasm, the other half is interacting with the extracellular matrix or extracellular fluids. Okay, so this is how the phospholipids are actually distributed in your membrane. Now let's look at an example here. Okay, before jumping to the example, I just want to show you this. So in reality, even though we are showing them as, you know, these structures, okay, in reality, this is how tightly they are packed. The molecules, the carbon atoms and the hydrogen atoms, they are packed so tightly. This is called the space filling model. Actually, in the membrane, they are packed so tightly. And because of this tight packing, you are getting a sealed membrane. Okay. However, whenever there is a double bond, you see the bend happening, right? This bend will actually disrupt the membrane. The membrane is still fluid-like, or it is able to move. It's not, I would say, completely why is this, just give me a second. Yeah, it's not rigid. Okay, it's not tightly packed because of the double bonds which are present in the fatty acids. So if there were no double bonds, you can imagine that they would have been packed tight like this. Okay, that's not the case. It's pushing it away. So this is also pushing it away. So you have lots and lots of gaps because of the double bonds that are introduced. I have to mention here that because of the double bonds, okay, I told you that you see a bend in the structure. Not just that, double bonds also reduce the melting point. That means if I take stearic acid, okay, stearic acid, and the stearic acid is I think it's a C18 carbon. Okay, so it's a carboxylic acid with 18 carbons, and this has a melting point of 69.6 degrees centigrade. Okay, if you take oleic acid is also a 18 carbon carboxylic acid, but it has one double bond. Okay, one double bond, and this, because of this one double bond, the melting point of oleic acid is 13.4 degrees centigrade. So you can see how a single double bond can actually make it and can actually reduce the melting point. Okay, can actually reduce the melting point. Okay, so the properties will depend on whether the fatty acid has a double bond or not. Okay, if it has a double bond, its melting temperature will drop and it is more fluid in the membrane. But if it is tightly packed, if it is saturated, then you get a compactly packed membrane. The fluidity will be lost. So in other words, the unsaturated fatty acids contribute to the fluidity of the membrane. Okay, one reason why the membrane is, that's just one reason. I'm not saying that this is the only reason. The one reason that the membrane is not absolutely jam-packed or tightly packed is because of the unsaturated fatty acids and the double bond causing a bend in the hydrophobic tails. Okay. Now, I'll show you a few examples. Okay, here we go. So this is the membrane of RBC, your red blood cells. The red blood cells has, you can see, so exoplasmic is the extracellular side. So within the membrane also, you have two layers, right? You have two layers. You have one layer here and the other layer here. Okay, so this layer is actually interacting with cytosol, and this layer is interacting with the extracellular fluid. So the distribution of the phospholipids will also vary. Okay, so towards the cytosolic side, you might see some phospholipid more. Towards the extracellular side, you might see some other phospholipid more. In this example, in the RBC, you are seeing sphingomyelin, okay, then phosphatidylcholine. These two are more towards the extracellular side, outside the cell. Okay, the layer which is present interacting with the outside world. Okay, towards the cytosolic side, what is happening? Towards the cytosolic side, you have more of phosphatidylserine, PS is phosphatidylserine, and you have more of phosphatidylethanolamine. Okay, phosphatidylethanolamine. So this is in the case of your RBC membrane. The distribution of phospholipids, I'm just telling you that the distribution of phospholipids will vary depending on the type of membrane. If you take the RBC outer layer, okay, the outer layer which is facing the extracellular fluid has a lot of sphingomyelin, phosphatidylcholine. But so this is the percentage of membrane lipid, okay, percentage. So more percentage of sphingomyelin and phosphatidylcholine in the extracellular membrane. Okay, extracellular half of the plasma membrane. So you can put this as two halves, right? This half is these two. Okay, but the internal half is these two. These two are in the internal half. You can look at the color coding also. So there's a lot of blue and pink outside and light green and dark green inside. Okay, the light greens and dark greens are your phosphatidylserine and phosphatidylethanolamine. The pink and the blue ones are sphingomyelin and phosphatidylcholine. Okay, those are present in the extracellular membrane. Okay, let's look at one more example. So this is from one of the published papers. You see the distribution. Are you able to see the lettering? It's too small, but can you see them?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Great, okay. So you can see the plasma membrane, okay, the plasma membrane has 42% phosphatidylcholine, 22% phosphatidylethanolamine, okay. Then phosphatidyl inositol is 4%, phosphatidylserine is 7%. Then you have sphingomyelin, which is 24%, and others is 1%. Take the endoplasmic reticulum. Endoplasmic reticulum, it's not having the same composition as the plasma membrane. Endoplasmic reticulum membrane has 55% phosphatidylcholine, 25% phosphatidylethanolamine. The phosphatidyl inositol is 10%. Phosphatidylserine is 5%. There is no sphingomyelin. Okay, there's no sphingomyelin in the endoplasmic reticulum membrane. Okay, so that is how the distribution will vary. Okay, the distribution can vary quite a bit. I'll leave you with one last example. This is from one of the standard textbooks. Distribution of phospholipids on the membrane. Okay, so inner membrane, outer layer. What's the distribution like? Okay, so phosphatidyl ethanolamine, 30%. Outer membrane, let's say this is around 10% maybe, probably. Okay, this is, so you can say total is 30%. So this is around, I would say 25 or 27%. And this is around 5%. Okay, so that is how these are actually distributed in the various phospholipids are actually distributed in the membrane. Okay, you see a small portion of phosphatidic acid also. Okay, the entire thing is around 5%. Phosphatidyl inositol, phosphatidyl inositol 4-phosphate, phosphatidyl inositol 4,5-bisphosphate, phosphatidic acid. The entire thing is around 5% of the total phospholipids that you can see in the membrane. Okay. Do you have any doubts so far? Great. Then, let me just go back here. Okay, then you have the sphingolipids. In the sphingolipids also, okay, the question is, do we need to remember the structures of these phospholipids and the components that are actually attached to them? Okay, as far as gait is concerned, I haven't seen a question being asked from the structures. That I can assure you. Okay, so as far as gait is concerned, I would say not necessary, but for other exams, they might be important. Okay, and if you are planning your future with this subject, that means if you are planning to change the field down the lane, you don't have to remember. But if you are planning to continue in this field, planning to do your PhD or planning to work in one of the biotechnology or biopharmaceutical companies, then yes, you have to remember these structures. Okay, you basically at least have to remember the basic glycerol, fatty acids, and you know, what derivative, what is the name given to that. If it is choline, it's called phosphatidylcholine. Things like that you have to remember. You might not, I mean, it's not necessary to remember the actual choline structure, but it's good to remember. Okay. So here we go. Now you have the sphingolipids. Okay, great. So now we have the sphingolipids with the phosphate moiety, the sphingosine backbone. And again, like I said before, you just have to assume that this is just a X. This X can be anything. So if you look at that part, this is where the names become a bit complicated. Okay, so unlike the normal glycerophospholipids where the names are quite straightforward except for cardiolipin. Okay, and you have to remember which ones are sphingolipids and which ones are phospholipids, glycerophospholipids. That you have to remember. Okay, that is important. Questions have been asked where which of these is actually a sphingolipid. Okay, so you have to remember which ones are actually sphingolipids and which ones are actually glycerophospholipids. Okay, so that is something that you have to remember. So here, if it is just hydrogen in a sphingolipid, we call it ceramide. Okay, if it is phosphocholine, we call it sphingomyelin. This is important. Sphingomyelin is very important. Okay, you have to remember this. Sphingomyelin has a phosphocholine attached. Okay, phosphocholine attached. Then if it is a carbohydrate like glucose that is attached, okay, we call it glucosyl cerebroside. Okay, glucosyl cerebroside. If it is a lactose molecule that is attached, then we call it lactosyl ceramide. Okay, lactosyl ceramide. Then if it is a complex oligosaccharide, the example for that is your gangliosides. Okay, gangliosides. So you have to remember these, which one is a sphingolipid and the names of these sphingolipids. Okay. I already gave you a brief introduction as to how the distribution of these lipids actually is. Okay. So the sphingosine backbone, you can have a monosaccharide or any of the other molecules. If there is a phosphate attached there, that becomes a sphingolipid or sphingophospholipid to be specific. If there is no phosphate attached there, it's a simple sphingolipid. Okay. Or most often when there's no phosphate attached, you see the attachment of a carbohydrate moiety like your monosaccharide or an oligosaccharide. That's the reason why these are under glycolipids. Okay, glycolipids have a sugar moiety attached to them. So you can have, again, you can have a glycerol backbone in a glycolipid or a sphingosine backbone in a glycolipid. So to be more specific, you can call this sphingoglycolipids. Sphingosine backbone with a sugar actually attached. There's no phosphate here. There's just a sugar molecule directly attached to the sphingosine backbone. If it is glyceroglycolipids, okay, or depending on the sugar that is attached, you can call them galactolipids or glucolipids. Okay, so it depends on what sugar is actually attached to it. Okay, it can be a monosaccharide or a disaccharide, which is attached to the glycerol backbone in addition to the fatty acids. Then we have the ether ones. Let me just.
Sir.
Yeah. Go ahead, please.
Sphingosine structure, sir.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. Just give me a second. I'm just checking. Just give me a second. should have it here. Let me just look for a structure. Okay, here we go. Okay, just give me a second. I'm just trying to find a better image. The one that I have is not good enough. Structure of Spinoza. So here's the structure of Spinoza. Close this. Yeah. So can you see the structure here? So this has a long chain here. Can you see the structure?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So basically, this basically has a long chain here. Okay, a long chain, CH, CH2. Oh, come on, what's happening? Okay, so it has a long chain, CH2, you see the pointer there, CH2, C double bond, CH, CH2, taken 12, CH3. Okay, it's just a long chain there of, and this pink thing, the pink thing is your Spinosian backbone, that's all. Okay? You can search for it in Google. It will take a minute, that's all. I had an image, but unfortunately it turned out to be a WebP image. The format is not supported by the tool that I'm using. That's the reason why it's not loading. Okay? Anyway, so that's about the Spinoza. Yeah. So These are ether lipids. So what we have seen in bacteria and eukaryotes is this kind of linkage. Okay. And this linkage is, I would say, more susceptible to reactions. That means this is not a stable bond. Okay, it can involve in several kinds of different kinds of reaction very quickly. So the molecules with this bond can actually easily react with other things. Okay, so this bond is not stable enough. Okay, the ester linkage is not stable enough. However, this linkage, ether linkage, is quite stable. Okay, it is less reactive. Okay, so
the screen is not.
Oh, you haven't shared your screen.
Okay. Whenever that happens, just make a point to inform me because I might. Okay, just give me a second. Okay. So, where were we? Yeah. So, are you able to see now?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. So, this is your ester linkage, which is found in your eukaryotes and bacteria, mammalian cells, and the one which we discussed till now, the ester linkage. Okay, where you see the reaction between an acid and an alcohol. Okay, and this bond, like I said, is more susceptible, or it is reactive. Okay, less stable. However, in the archaea, the membrane contains ether lipids. Okay, the reason why they have ether lipids is ether lipid is very stable. It's not reactive. It can withstand more. So it can basically give more stability when compared to the ester linkage. Okay. And why do these bacteria need the ether linked membranes, ether linked phospholipids or ether linked glycolipids in their membranes? The reason why they need them is because these bacteria live under extreme conditions. Under extreme conditions. So when I say extreme conditions, in the seabed, okay, so they are under extreme water pressure, right? In the volcanoes, they are extreme, they're susceptible to extreme temperatures. So they have to withstand all that. And in order to withstand all that, their membrane has to be more stable than the membranes of your bacteria or the mammals. That's the reason why they have the ether linked phospholipids in their structure. Okay, so let's just go back to, here we go. So they have the ether linked and they have a different structure, but basically what you have to remember here is they have an ether linkage, not the ester linkage. That's good enough. Okay, that part is, if you can remember that part, and these ether linked ones are actually present in your archaea. And why do they have them? Because they live in extreme conditions and they need more stable or less reactive membrane that is actually found in your eukaryotes and other bacteria. Okay, so that is about the archaea. Okay, archaea have long isoprenoid tails. This also you can remember, isoprenoid tails. Okay, unlike bacteria and eukaryotes, which have fatty acid tails, these have isoprenoid tails. Okay, isoprenoid tails. The other difference is they have ether linkage, we have ester linkage. They have ether linkage and we have ester linkage. Okay, so that's the difference that you have to remember. And you also have to remember that ether linkage is less susceptible or more stable when compared to the ester linkage. Okay. So then we look at the structure of another important lipid, which is cholesterol. Okay, just cholesterol. So this will be the last topic here. And then, we're almost out of time. So tomorrow we'll start discussing the functions of lipids, and then we'll even finish the nucleotide and purine pyrimidine basic structures. Okay. So let's look at cholesterol here. The cholesterol has what we call a steroid nucleus. This part is called the steroid nucleus. Okay, and a hydrophobic tail. A hydrophobic tail and a steroid nucleus. This part, because of the hydroxyl group, this part can actually interact with water. So this is hydrophilic and the tail is hydrophobic. Okay, and this ring, this has a name. Okay, the ring has a name. It's called cyclopentanoperhydrophenanthrin ring. You have to remember this name. Cyclopentanoperhydrophenanthrin ring. Okay, so it's made up of four rings and it's called cyclopentanoperhydrophenanthrin ring. In total, it has 27 carbon atoms and one hydroxyl group at position three. Okay, so there's a double bond between carbon atoms 5 and 6, and the 8th carbon atom is beta oriented side chain attached to the 17th carbon atom. Okay, this part you don't have to remember, but just remember that at the third position it has a hydroxyl group. Okay, the entire thing is called steroid nucleus, and the name of the steroid nucleus is actually cyclopentanoperhydrophenanthrin. Okay, and this is also an amphipathic molecule with a hydrophobic tail. Okay, those are the things that you have to remember about cholesterol. Right, so that is about the structure of the cholesterol. I'll give you a detailed picture. We'll talk about the functions of cholesterol. So this is the polar head, the steroid nucleus, and then you have the alkyl side chain. This part will behave as the hydrophobic part. The alkyl side chain is the hydrophobic part. So this is how the structure is in a space filling model. So in reality, the structure will look something like this. Okay, something like what you are seeing here. Okay, so the cholesterol molecule will look something like this. And this is called cyclopentanoperhydrophenanthrin ring. Okay. Now, the cholesterol, it has many functions. One important one is it is present in the membrane as well. Just like your phospholipids, the cholesterol gets inserted in the membranes, and the cholesterol will increase the fluidity even more. I told you, whenever there is a double bond, because of the bend in the double bond, because the bend caused by the double bond, you see the fluidity of the membrane increasing. The cholesterol getting inserted between these phospholipids will also have the same effect. So cholesterol actually contributes to, so basically it disrupts the tight packing of the fatty acid chains. Therefore, it actually contributes to the fluidity of the membrane. Okay, so this is where we'll stop for today. And tomorrow we'll pick it up from here. We'll discuss the functions, some more functions of cholesterol, and then the functions of lipids as a whole. Okay, that will be our topic for tomorrow. And then we'll start the introduction to nucleic acid, the various structures and other components as well.